Good afternoon, Honorable Minister. Good afternoon, ladies, and most welcome, many gentlemen as well. To share this very interesting journey that is now starting. We started in Cairo, the Africa Water Week, with Rosemary Robb and Amco, Phoebe, and Honorable Minister Mugamba as well, on using this fantastic space that the Amco is offering for gender, a forum of commitment where finally we can start converging, learning together on making gender work as concrete actions. This is an effort in my presentation to take up the challenge and start harvesting. A lot of work has been done, as Mercy told. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. We just got a presentation as well on a lot of work that is already happening. And let us try and unpack what does it mean gender equality in water. And it is huge. This is an opportunity in November. We will continue in the Freshwater Governance Conference that's organized by the Water Research Commission in South Africa. And we hope to have a gender summit next year. So what I'm going to present now will be completely different after a year because we have had the discussions on how to do it even more concrete. I'm going to talk about, okay, policy, about what? Capacity building, what are we talking about? On the substance, the indicators, what do we mean by gender equality in water for all these different objectives that are now on the table? Which means somehow defining what is gender equality in water. We talk about equal rights, equal opportunities. We talk about the economic, political, cultural, social dimensions, about water development, about water management. Equality doesn't mean being the same. We all know that it is about valuing also the differences between men and women. Women are more vulnerable for sexual harassment. Of course, the whole labor division, women more in charge of the domestic chores, men more the productive activities. So we have to take those differences into account. And basically understanding what are the gender gaps now and moving towards equality, setting ambitious but very realistic and of course indicators to be reached in a certain time. If you talk about gender equality in water, water is a difficult resource. Because the different users have different quantities, need different qualities. We all need water for domestic uses. It's universal, but for productive uses, it is context specific. Water is, especially for productive uses, an input. We also need very much the land tenure issues, the markets, etc. And we are talking not about access to water resources as it is naturally available, but it is the huge effort of bringing the water through infrastructure and technologies to the right place in the right time, right quantities, right qualities. So we are talking about a huge effort that you wouldn't make if you didn't get benefits out of it. For gender, we think it's good to distinguish. On the one hand, we talk about women as users, and especially the focus of the food insecure population, the poor rural and peri-urban areas. We talk about women as users as a target group of public investments, NGOs, government. A lot of self-supply by the poor as well, where the people themselves invest in technologies, both men and women. But we also talk about men and women as we are sitting here, the water professionals, the service providers, the water managers, and also the business of water provision. I think it's good to keep those differences because more women in governments, in like our shining example of Uganda, always the question, what does it mean for the services that the government delivers? These are two different issues that hopefully go together, but not necessarily. And especially for the service delivery, of course, we count very much on our male colleagues as well. If I take a picture of this and to structure my presentation in the end, as well, on the one hand, we talk about the livelihood benefits for especially the women and men as water users. I'm using criteria here that Ruth may come back upon when she's going to talk about the Women in Agriculture Empowerment Index. So we have our shining stars. This is what we want to achieve. And on the other hand, we have the water resource. In between is the level of the technology, where we get the access to the resource. And then the link to the livelihoods are the water users. And it's clear there are multiple water users. People need water for multiple water users. So the question, what is the gender equality in the multiple water users, comes up. And this all is then underpinned by gender relations in many different ways. So I'm going to talk about these different levels. The first is what the women and men as users, taking a livelihoods approach, as was already mentioned. If we think about gender, not by the sectors of the in the water sector, but the livelihoods, the alleviation of women's domestic chores of water fetching and girls, it has received a lot of attention. And in an integrated approach, the question is really, can irrigation engineers design canals that then put the girls and the children in danger because they have forgotten the domestic uses? Can there be water development without even thinking about domestic uses and the need to alleviate women's burdens as a priority across the water sector? But similarly, if we talk about water development and productive uses, women are producers as well, in a context-specific way. And also for the domestic sector, what are the opportunities then to address the productive water needs of women as well? One problem of why the productive sector is so behind is the context specificity of productive water uses. Here, this is a map of Ghana, in which we tried to highlight the diversity in women's involvement in farming. The darkest green women mostly involved in the matrilineal Ashanti areas, but in the northern region, women are just less involved in farming. And of course, it has implications for the targeting of productive water use technologies and interventions. Talking both about women as female heads of household, but very much the majority of women who live together with their husbands, and especially in informal areas, they work together. So from a livelihoods perspective, domestic uses alleviation of the priority for everybody, and at the same time, both women and men are producers and need water for that. An opportunity in the domestic sector to also address the productive water uses that comes up is bringing multiple use water services to homesteads for health and time, for food and income, from crops, from enterprise, and even from homestead-based fisheries. So that not knowing that this is already happening, but making it even a universal human right, not 25 liter, but 50 to 100 liter per person per day, close to homesteads where women and the landless tend to have a larger, stronger say over the output, as a win-win investment for meeting especially women's domestic and productive needs. Just an idea. Then we move to the users. When we talk about gender equality in the users, we hardly know about it. This is just an example of a village where we look at the different water sources, the type of users, and just start counting. The stream, how many male cattle owners are using it, how many women are still using it for domestic uses, etc. This type of inventories have never been made, as far as I know, but would be a way to measure then the uses. So the users that in the end lead to the livelihood benefits. But here, as you also very much mentioned, The use of water alone is not the issue. A lot of other things are needed to make beneficial use of water. Without hygiene education, the cleanest water supply doesn't work. Without addressing, for example, the safety issues for women transporting water, whether it is for productive uses or domestic uses, it wouldn't work. Land tenure, key aspects. Without land tenure security, women couldn't invest long-term in their own pumps, for example. The other production factors, etc. So for gender equality in water, we need a lot of partnerships with the groups that work on the factors that make water use into a livelihood benefit. Then I move to the technologies and the type of questions, the gender equality in control of technology. A lot of similarities for any water use when we talk about the planning phases, the participatory planning. Are women and men, in that case, included? It won't be, thank you. Included in the planning, in the selection of the technology, in the siting of the technology, when there are land issues, to whom is the new land allocated, what happens to the displacements, etc. All these issues are gendered. In water associations, that came already up, the question that women should participate, but what are the type of quotas? Wouldn't domestic of more water supply committees, shouldn't they have more women than men even? And in areas, for example in Pakistan, half women doesn't make much sense. But in areas in Africa, 90% women should be normal because that's the percentage of women producers, for example, in wetlands. So thinking a bit deeper on the quota when we talk about the representation of women and men in associations. Then the not women as investors themselves.